Yes, the answer to that is we can. If I can get back to maps like this, I think the first thing is really to build biographical databases, and that's the crucial part of that. And then if you build a biographical database and with an eye to spatially enabling it, then the problem is solved right there. But there's another thing in intellectual history that really got me interested in this. What I've been talking about today, the last part that I really rushed through, is about spatial ontology, that is, conceptions of space. It seems to me that I once explained to a scholar in China that in America, when they draw a county boundary and if it goes through a house, then if your bedroom is in that school district versus this school district, you know, you can split up the family according to where, which bedroom they sleep in, at the extreme end. And he looked at me and said, nah, you don't do that. They'll draw the boundary and make it go around the house. And I said, no, boundaries, you know, trump houses in America, not in China. And so one of the questions to ask is so how did people conceive of space, and what's the relationship between conceptions of space and social practice and political practice? And if this is, why do we think this is constant over 2,000 years? It's not. And why do we think it's regular across space, across regions, when it's not? And I won't go into, I can go into great detail about this, but that actually is a really interesting intellectual problem. And so then I started to, as an intellectual historian, started to, well, let's see what geographers say. And it turns out they're arguing about this all the time. People have lots to say about spatial conceptions. And is human geography more important than physical geography and things like this? So I discovered a whole area of intellectual history I didn't know about.